Good morning, everyone, and welcome to EDP and Applied Mathematics Seminar. It's a pleasure for me to open session 35 of this seminar. Today, we have two excellent speakers, Mario Tuznaque and Zorin Miku. Buenas tardes, sean bienvenidos todos al seminario EDP y Matemática Aplicada, la sesión 35. El día de hoy tenemos dos grandes pesquisadores, el profesor Mario Tuznaque y el profesor Zorin Miku. Introducing Mario Tuznaque, we have to Professor Diego Souza. Thank you, Diego. You can start.
Okay, thank you, Juan. So for me, it's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Mario Tuznaque. Professor Mario Tuznaque is full professor in Université de Bordeaux in France. He's originally from Romania. And he is a well-known mathematician. He has more than almost 2,000 citations in MathSciNet. And he's very famous for his very nice book on observability and stabilization. He has many publications, almost 100 of papers. And so for us, it's a great honor to have you here in our seminar. And today he's going to talk about reachable state for infinite dimensional linear system, old and new. So thank you. You can start when you want.
Thank you very much for this very nice introduction. So I also would like to thank Juan for the invitation to make a talk in this seminar. Somehow I feel being in Rio, which is a very nice sensation, yeah, even if it's artificial. But so I will try to discuss today something which I think it's one of the most important problems in controllability theory, which is discussing properties of the reachable space for dynamical systems, for linear dynamical systems. Of course, the question is very interesting also for nonlinear ones, but it's much more difficult and very few things are available. It's a problem which has not been looked very much in the infinite dimensional setting for PDEs, but which is really fundamental in the finite dimensional system theory. And the progress for PDEs, for infinite dimensional systems, are very recent and very spectacular in the last 4 years, let's say. I will try to present some of this progress, but in fact, I will just mention them briefly. And what I will insist on is a very recent result of ours and its applications, which allow us two things, to see a class of infinite dimensional system of exactly controllable ones, even they are not strictly speaking, but to recover some of the properties of exactly controllable systems, and also to look to the robustness of this concept of reachable space with respect to some perturbations. So this is the outline of the presentation. First, our motivation and background. Then I will discuss in an abstract setting the robustness of this reachable space with respect to perturbations of the generator. And then I will discuss the applications to a class of system described by the heat equations, which are somehow the most fascinating ones, the most interesting ones, although the problem makes sense and may be difficult also for system described by the wave equation. Maybe I will say two words on that at the appropriate moment. So, motivation and background. Well, the systems I will consider can be abstractly described by a generator A. So we have it We have it here, so does it work? One moment to see something. Oh, no, not this is not what I wanted. Sorry. Now I did something which is not okay. A sharp. Okay, so now I'm again in the... Something is not working well. I'm a bit sorry. Okay, so it's no problem. So my systems will be described by A, a generator, a semi-group generator, and B, a control operator. Z of t is the state of instant t. The basic example is ODEs, of course, where A and B are matrices of appropriate dimensions. Well, for the systems we are interested in, A will be a semi-group generator, and B will be what's called a control operator, which goes from U to a space which is in fact often larger than the space X, is an extrapolation space called X minus one. And this complication is needed in order to englobe a boundary control problem. So allowing here operators B, which are unbounded. So this means that they go to X minus one, called control operators, allows us to englobe in this framework boundary control problems. So the operator A is supposed to generate a C0 semigroup called the capital T, or bold T, if you prefer. And so this X minus one is nothing else is but the dual of the domain of A star with respect to the pivot space X, but you don't really need to know what it is. It's a space larger than X. Okay. Now, what happens here? I lost my... However, I need something to give sense to my system. I need a property which is called admissibility. So at a set, at the first level, let us assume one moment that B is bounded. Then the solution of my differential equation, which is here, Z dot is equal to AZ plus BU, will be given by the semigroup applied to the initial state Z of zero, plus an operator phi t applied to U, which is called the input map. So this operator phi t is called input map, and it's given by the variation of constants formula, integral from zero to t of t index small t minus sigma b u of sigma d sigma. So in the case when b is bounded, this integral, the quantity which I'm integrated lies in x, and of course the integral will also lie in x. However, as I mentioned, in general, b is not with values in x, but with values in x minus one. So it makes sense to define a concept which is called an admissible control operator, which means that the range of this operator phi t is in x, even if b does not take values in x. So this property, it's very important to give sense to my system and to say that my natural space will be the space capital X. So a basic example to give, when you give a definition, you need of course to give an example where it makes sense. As I mentioned, it makes sense when B is bounded, but to have a definition also, you need to say that there is at least one example with B unbounded, and to give one, I have here one. So I take an operator A, which is negative, strictly negative. So A is equal to minus A zero, where A zero is self-adjoint and positive. And then I take an operator B with degree, what's called degree of unboundedness, which is less than one half. Then it is easily proved by usual energy estimate that such an operator is admissible. So in other words, if my operator A is negative, strictly negative, and my B is unbounded, but not too much, then such a B will be admissible. So this is a typical example, which will appear later on in this presentation. So this is a framework in which I defined the concept of reachable space. So the reachable space is nothing else but the range of this red operator phi t. The reachable space at instant t is range of phi t. So this is a space I will be interested in. And it's an essential space in quantum theory. What does this space tell you? So if my initial data is zero, then it is z of t. It will be the solution. What does this range tell us? Tells us what we can do. How can you influence the system? This space is the most precise measure of our capacity of influencing the system. From zero, which are the states which I can obtain? Of course, sometime which I can obtain with controls, which are L2 in time with values in capital U. Of course, sometimes I need to add constraints on the control. So for instance, I can ask my control to be bounded by an a priori bound. Nevertheless, even in this case, knowing which is this space will give me very precise information on our capability of influencing the system. The question is well understood for finite dimensional systems. First of all, let me remind in the finite dimensional case that controllability means that the operator phi tau in time tau, controllability in time tau, would mean that the range of phi tau is all the space X, in other words, that the operator phi tau is on. So that's the definition of controllability in finite dimensions. And it turns out that even if a priori this definition depends on time, I said controllability in time tau, at the end of the day, it is time independent because there is a famous theorem of Kalman, which says that for any positive tau, this range is equal to the range of what's called the Kalman matrix. It's this matrix is obtained, so B will be a matrix of a certain size. Then I multiply it by A square up to A power N minus one, and we juxtapose them. We get a big matrix, which is called the Kalman matrix. And Karlsruhe's result says that the range of phi tau is the range of this matrix. So in particular, it does not depend on tau. So this is a bit strange. It looks a bit strange because it says that what you can do in a small time is the same thing with what you can do in a very large one. This is not exactly true because, so it is true strictly speaking, but in fact, what we can do in a long time can also be done in a short time, but we need a lot of energy. So in fact, what happens is that to reach a final state in this algebraic, finally, space, if you want to do this in a very short time, you will need a huge amount of energy. But since we are not imposing constraints on the controls, at this stage, we do not care about that. What else can we say in finite dimension? All linear time invariant systems, so described by z dot is equal to az plus bu, can be seen as controllable ones. Indeed, it is easy to check that I always have that the range of b is included in range of phi tau, which means that if I denote by a tilde the restriction of a to range of phi tau, the system determined by the matrix A tilde and by B with state space range of phi tau is always controllable. So this can be seen as a banality, but we'll come back to it. It's a very important remark when we go to infinite dimensional spaces. And moreover, what happens is not proved here, but is not difficult to check, that What I can obtain with controls which are L2 in time is the same thing which I can obtain with very smooth control. For instance, control functions which can be extended to holomorphic ones from C to U. So in fact, if I take a much smaller class of controls, meaning that they are holomorphic, at the end, again, I obtain the same reachable space. This is not very difficult to check, and it's a consequence of the previous, in fact, of the previous assertion. We will see that most of these things become false. Most of the things which I wrote here become false for infinite dimensional systems. So what can happen? The range of phi tau generally depends on tau, and it is not a closed subspace of X in general. So how can we see that? Imagine you have a string equation. Imagine you have a string equation. I'll try to see if I do like this, it's working better. Stile. I take a string equation, let's say on the interval 0 pi. And I'm controlling at one end. I put a control here for a string. Then it's known that the system is not controllable. Not controllable, not even approximately for a string. So for the wave equation, if t is the time tau, it's smaller than twice the length. So I have, this means that in fact I have a very small reachable space, or at least a reachable space which I can eventually characterize. But this means in fact that the range of phi tau for such tau will be included, of course, but different of the state space X. When tau is larger, now if I take tau larger than 2 pi, then my system is exactly controllable, which in terms of reachable space means that the range of this operator is all of X. So here I have a basic example where my range of phi tau does not depend does depend on X. What is true is that this reachable space can always be organized as a Hilbert space. In fact, if I endow it with this norm, which is the L2 norm, the norm in L2 of 0 tau u, which is transported via the map phi tau, then it is always a reachable space, which will be isomorphic to the kernel of, to the orthogonal of the kernel of phi tau. So it will be always isomorphic to this space, which is of course a Hilbert space. But in general, for an infinite dimensional system, we are unable to say, what is this space? What is this space range of phi tau? Since very recently, we are unable to say, with the exception of the case when I have exact controllability, in the case where, of course, it's all the space. One of the interests of the concept of reachable space is that it allows a very compact definition and an interesting view on the notion of controllability for infinite dimensions. So for finite dimension, I just say what controllability means. I had only one concept. For infinite dimensional systems, for PDEs, I have at least three of them. The first one is what's called exact controllability. So exact controllability which is that, as I already mentioned, the range of the operator phi tau is all of X. It means that from the initial state zero, I can reach any final state in time tau. As I mentioned, this is time dependent in general for infinite dimensional space. Then you have null controllability, which in fact, the way I define you is maybe unusual for some of you, but I will make the connections immediately. The definition is right, the range of phi tau contains the range of the semigroup. This is equivalent, as mentioned here, to the existence for every initial state of a control, such as solution, the solution at instant tau vanishes. Why that? It's very simple, because here, I have Z of tau. I try to write better, Z of tau is equal to the semigroup at instant tau, which I already wrote, applied to the initial state, plus the input map phi tau applied to you. So if I want this sum to vanish, it means that I want to solve the equation phi tau u is equal to minus t tau of z0. I want to be this equal to minus this, which means to be able to do that, whatever the initial state z0 is, I need to have the range of phi tau to contain the range of t tau, and this is clearly equivalent. And then we have the notion of approximate controllability, which in time tau, which means that the range of phi tau is dense in X. All these concepts can be true in some time, but false in smaller times, in infinite dimensions. But when I go back to the finite dimensional situation, all these concepts coincide with the usual controllability concept. So this is a true generalization. So here I already mentioned that in finite dimensions, all the linear time invariant system can be seen as controllable ones. And that the range of phi tau coincides with the range of the restriction of phi tau to signals which are very smooth. In the finite dimensional context, I immediately see that I have situations where I have no chance of getting the controllability, is namely the case where the operator A is negative and B is not too unbounded. In this case, I have no hope of having exact controllability. And essentially, this is due to the fact that the range of phi tau in this situation will contain very smooth functions, very smooth in a certain sense, which will appear, I hope, quickly enough. And it turns also out that if I restrict A to the range of phi tau, then the new system will not in general be exactly controllable. A typical example is here, which on which Sorin is one of the first to have worked on. So if I consider the heat equation, so heat equation, heat, well, it's not working well, my, on a half interval. So I take zero here, infinity, and here is the control, it's here. Then I have the property that the range of phi tau, so the input map, I don't write the equations here. Maybe I will come back later to that. Range of phi tau cap range of the semigroup. Is the empty set for every tau. So here there is no chance already to have even null controllability. And also, if I restrict my semigroup to the range of phi tau, I will get nothing. I will certainly not go to the range of phi tau because I will go to a much smaller space. Okay, so now a question which is interesting is what can I say about the robustness of the reachable space with respect to perturbations. Why am I interested? So first of all, I mentioned a difficult problem is to find the reachable space for an infinite dimensional system. Suppose I found it for a given equation. I will give an interesting example for the heat equation quite quickly. The question is, okay, but now I want to do small perturbations to add nonlinearities. How will things happen? So in fact, the first remark is that the reachable space is not robust to perturbation, which are small in the usual norms, even for linear systems. It's an easy exercise using Kalman matrix. On the other hand, for finite or infinite dimensional LTIs, which are exactly controllable, this is robust with respect to small perturbation. This is a result which has been proved by Said Ad. It's a known result. The question is, what can we do if the system is not exactly controllable? So we have always in mind the heat equation. This is very interesting because this will allow us by a fixed point method, for instance, to tackle nonlinear problems. I will not explain this here because I feel I'm already a bit short of time. So I really want to go to the interesting things, but what one should have that exact controllability is robust with respect to nonlinearities, which means that I can add nonlinearities and then my exactly controllable system will keep some exact controllability property, but locally, which means for small initial data. Which is a class of system which seems to be interesting for our approach. It's the systems which are non-controllable in any time. And why that? As I mentioned, the reachable space a priori depends on time. It turns out that for systems which are non-controllable in any time, the concept is time independent. So we have this theorem, which goes back to Fattorini and Zeidman, which says that if a system is non-controllable at any time, that the range of its time does not depend on time. So here you have the proof. The proof is all here. What is the idea? What is obvious is that the range of phi tau is included in the range of phi t if t is larger than tau. It's intuitively obvious and mathematically very simple. Why? Because what I can do in a shorter time tau, of course, I will can also do in a longer one. That's all what I'm saying here. Then there is these free line proofs, which should be illustrated by a small picture. I'll try to illustrate it by a small picture. So I have, imagine I have here the time axis. And then what does it mean that I have a point which is in range of phi t? So I have here t, in range of phi t, I have here tau. And I have a point eta, let's say, which belongs to the range of phi t. What does it mean? That I can go from zero and draw a trajectory which leads me to eta here, to eta at time t. Okay, then what I do? I just shift this trajectory with t minus tau at the left. So I shift, in the sense of the picture, I translated it to the left of t minus tau. And then I have a curve which goes from eta equal to zero here, and a tau will reach eta. Then I look better to this curve. What is this curve? So eta is this trajectory, which is in fact the same as SW of T. So this trajectory, I call it W. And this one, the shifted one, I call it W tilt. So I know that eta is W of T, but it's also W dot tilde of T. Of tau is W dot tilde of tau. And then what I can say, it is also this trajectory W dot has some value for the time equal to zero. So it is T tau applied to the solution, the semigroup applied to the solution at T equal to zero, plus the input map applied to U tilde, where a U tilde is a shifted control. Because when I shifted the trajectory, I need also to shift the control. And now I'm done, because T tau applied to something belongs to the range of phi tau because of the null controllability in any time. Here, more precisely, in time tau. So in fact, this sum belongs to range of phi tau, and I'm done. So I took an arbitrary element in the range of phi t, and I show that it's in the range of phi tau. So this is extremely general. I don't care which are the equations governing the system. The only thing I need is to have it controllable in any time. So this is one of the rare proofs I will give you. Now, let me go to the main topic, which is this robustness property. And we have the following result. So these systems which I introduced are interesting because now I can speak about a reachable space without specifying in time tau. It is the same whatever tau is. The same algebraically, topologically, there is another discussion. Then I have the following result, which is one of the important ones, which says that if I have a system which is null controllable in any time, and I take a perturbation of the generator, which is small, but when applied in this norm, in the norm of the linear operators of range of phi tau zero for some tau zero. So what I need this, so what I'm doing here is not very clear. I'm afraid I didn't write everything. So here my generator A, why doesn't it work? Still, instead of the generator A, I go to the generator A plus P. And this generator I take is small in this norm. So this is very abstract because for applications, what is this norm? If I have an exactly controllable system, it will be the norm of X. But for the heat equation, for instance, what is this? We don't know. It's completely abstract. So this is a first result for small perturbations. And I have another result, which is for some compact perturbations, which I don't make precise here. It's my theorem two. I will give examples later on. So it's a bit complicated. So here P in the first theorem, roughly speaking, P is small. In the second one, P is compact, but again, with respect to this topology of phi tau. What is important here is maybe the main ingredient with this is this theorem in a recent paper with Sylvain Verdoza and Kevin Lebalch, which says that in fact, when I restrict my semigroup to the range of phi tau, again, all my system will be exactly null controllable at any time. Okay, so it bears perfectly sense to speak about the restriction of the semigroup to range of phi tau. Then this is again a C0 semigroup on this space, which a priori, if you think to the heat equation, this space is much, much smaller than the initial space. We'll come with an example immediately. So in fact, the main ingredient is this result, which is extremely nice. So in other words, I have now this property, which I like a lot. When I restrict to the reachable space, my system becomes an exactly controllable one. That's the main conclusion here. So here I prepared a detailed proof. It's not complicated, but maybe I will skip it for the moment. To go to the applications to the heat equation, because I'm conscious, I spoke a lot about abstract settings. So let me come to the heat equation. And I take the heat equation with Neumann boundary control at both ends. So I have here my heat equation on the interval 0 pi, x in 0 pi. And I control with Neumann boundary control at both ends, take initial data 0. So what is the input map here? The input map here will be phi tau applied to the couple u0 u pi, which I call u. It's a couple u0 u pi. It will be just the value of the solution z at instant tau. So a priori, it is a function defined on the interval 0 pi. The question is, how can I characterize all the possible functions z of tau? Okay, so that's the question of determining the reachable space. And this was unknown until very recently. And the result which has been obtained in a series of paper, which indeed has some background in Fattorini and Russell's classical paper, but all these papers, the basic papers are two very recent ones of Hartmann, Orsoni, and of myself with Hartmann and Kellet, we say that all the functions which I can reach a priori, as I mentioned, they are defined on 0 pi, are those functions which admit an extension which is holomorphic in this square D, this red square D, which is defined algebraically or by the constraints modulus of y smaller than x and y modulus of y smaller than pi minus x, but it's exactly v square, and which are in the Sobolev space W1 of D at the same time. So S and F prime are L2. So they are holomorphic. So a priori, the functions which I can reach are on 0 pi, but in fact, they need to be extendable to holomorphically in V square. For instance, what I can say with this result, I can say that the function 1 over x minus pi 2 squared plus a squared, for instance, everything squared, it's a very nice function. If I look on the interval 0x with modulus of a smaller than pi over 2, such a function is not reachable. You'll never find a control L2 to reach from zero in such a, why? Because you will have a singularity somewhere here inside. Here you have a non-integrable singularity, such a function which is C infinity, super nice on the interval zero pi, you'll never be able to reach. Okay, but so as I mentioned, this is a result which I will not at all discuss. It's a series of papers which have been published very recently. And many people became interested in this issue. Here we have an equality for the reachable space. Then my question is, how can I perturb this? So this is not a simple proof. And then a first type of perturbation is to add potentials. I add potential P of X, which are small, but in which space? In this A1D of space. So to apply my perturbation result, my abstract perturbation result, I need to know what the reachable space is. Here I know. So if my polynomial PFX, I add a potential PFX, which is a holomorphic function in D and small with respect to this norm, then my reachable space will be the same. So that's what we are saying here. In fact, I need slightly more. I need the potential to be holomorphic and small in the norm W1 infinity, because here I will multiply by Z. So I need or the term to be small. So this is the first application, which is completely new. Then there are applications to integral perturbation in the style of Zuazua and Fernandez Cara. And here we are able somehow to adapt the results with this kind of results with much weaker assumptions on the kernel K than theirs. They have assumptions, roughly speaking, which ask K to be holomorphic in a very big set and also to vanish at the extremities. Here we can strengthen their results. So in other words, weaken a lot the assumptions on K and prove that we can keep the reachable space and also the null controllability property, because the aim was not the reachable space, the aim was null controllability, although the method they used implicitly used the reachable space. So that's another application.
So sorry, Marius.
Yes.
K depend on time, K, the kernel depend on time as well?
Can depend on time also, yes. Can also depend on time. There are precise assumptions with K depending on time. It's roughly speaking at infinity in time with values in this space A12. So it's still robust. It can depend on time. And also some nonlinear problems. So if I add nonlinearities, so I add to my heat equation a nonlinearity f of txz with this nonlinearity being analytic with respect to the last variable to z. So if I write it like this and with some smallness condition, then every space in the every state in the reachable space in this space. So here I will take more derivatives with respect to S, more regular states, all functions which up to the first derivatives are of course holomorphic and small in the L2 norm can be reached by a means of a control, which is L2. So this is also an interesting result. And where is a strong part is that my perturbations are asked to be small only in D. I don't know, need to go above. If you look to all the results which are available in the literature, they ask a kind of smallness condition on conditions is a much larger, in a much larger set. So these are some applications which are quite straightforward of our abstract results. So you will certainly ask me, what about several space dimensions? The difficulty in several space dimensions is that in general, we do not know the reachable space, but so the internal control I will answer is not a problem. And as I mentioned, polynomial nonlinearities are already understood by now. So in fact, the difficult problem would be what about linear problems in several space dimensions? And I will come back immediately to that. Let me also mention something which I implicitly used for my nonlinear problem is that we are able, if we know the reachable space, to say what is the reachable space with smooth inputs. So for instance, for the heat equation, we are able to give the heat equation, the reachable space which with controls, which are in this space Wn2L of zero tau, which are the functions. So n times differentiable in the distribution sense and which vanish up to the n minus one derivative at t equal to zero. Then for this one, we have exactly what the reachable space is. And we conjecture that in fact, with functions which are in a Jevre class, we can reach all the targets, this is for the heat equation, all the targets which are holomorphic in a neighborhood of this diamond D. But okay, this is something. And also there are connections with a very interesting problem, which is the cost of null controllability at any time, which I will not detail. I will just finish by mentioning that we have now something in several space dimensions, which we have used in our paper with Sylvain and Kevin. In fact, so we have some results also with perturbation in several space dimensions, and they are based on our abstract perturbation result, of course, but also on the result for the multidimensional heat equation. So if you take the heat equation in a ball, omega here, it's important to be a ball, with control on the whole boundary, then you don't know exactly what the reachable space is, but you know that the reachable space contain the functions holomorphic of, so holomorphic of several complex variables, of n complex variable, which are holomorphic in a neighborhood of this set E of omega. So in fact, this set looks very complicated, but if I go here, if I go to my my diamond, which was like that, if you remember, so I, doesn't work well, but I will finish by the way. It means the set of functions which are reachable here, which are shown to be reachable, they are not all of them, but there are a lot of them, are those which are holomorphic in a arbitrarily small, larger one. So if I take this, the set E of omega will be just the usual diamond in 1D, and then this space, it suffices to take functions which are holomorphic in a larger one. A very nice proof of Stromauer and Waters from 2020 show that if omega is a ball, then we have this information on the reachable space. So we can use it to study nonlinear problems, to study perturbation, things which have done, but it's completely open to do things for other geometries. For instance, for a rectangle, we don't know, rectangle in 2D, we have a good guess, but we don't know what the reachable space is. So I think I will stop here. I hope I wasn't too long. And I'm open to questions or remarks.
Thank you very much for this very, very nice talk, Marius. So now we open the turn for questions and comments. So if anyone has some question or comment, you can open your microphone or type your question in the chat.
Ah, so there are some questions maybe in the chat.
Let's see.
Not yet, no.
No, so
there are some messages, but no, not questions.
Marius, for instance, we know, you know, what is the reachable set for the heat equation in 1D, and then you talk about some robustness for nonlinearities, right?
In particular, yes, yeah.
Yes, and it can you get something for the Burgess equation? For the type of nonlinearity of the Burgess equation?
No, not yet. There is the problem is that, so as I mentioned, the main, our main tool, I'll come back, is this theorem, free.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then when you think the way we tackle Burgers equation, for instance, for the null controllability property, we use a lot the fact that the semigroup is analytic. Mm-hmm. We use the smoothing effect when we do the fixed point for Burgers. The problem is that, so because I somehow we need to control the derivative. Mm-hmm. It turns out that this semigroup, when I restrict it to range of tau, I don't know anymore if it is analytic or not. My guess, it will no longer be an analytic one, but it still will be some smoothing effect. So the problem is that to tackle nonlinearities like Burgers or even linear terms which contain derivatives, mm-hmm. I need some smoothing effect. And I need the smoothing effect again with respect to this space range of tau, mm-hmm. Which is not clear for the moment. This is an interesting open question, but I'm sure there are very interesting things to be done. So that's an open question. What about the smoothing properties of the semigroup when you restrict it to the range of phi tau? We don't know. And that's, in a way, a condition to do correctly Burgers. And also to do potentials which are not small. If you remarked, I am restricted to potential perturbations which are even without derivatives, but which need to be small with respect again to this norm, which is not natural. This, in the linear case, this is not natural, but I'm unable to do better for the moment.
Nice. So in the case and the improvement concerning the paper with no local terms, so you have also you have also the smallness assumption, right? On the curve.
There is no smallness assumption. There is no smallness assumption. There is only smoothness assumptions. Why? Because this perturbation, this type of perturbation, even with respect to the spaces I consider, is compact.
Is compact. Okay. Okay.
So it's compact. So I apply the second perturbation result. As I mentioned, we have two abstract perturbation result, one involving a smallness condition and the other one involving a compactness condition. Compactness uniqueness condition, in fact. We use a compactness uniqueness method as for an exactly controllable system. That's the idea. For exactly controllable systems, we have two tools, basically for perturbation, smallness and compactness uniqueness. Mm-hmm. Compactness uniqueness for parabolic case, it was not known. It was a bit used in the paper of Zuazua and Fernandez Cara, but it was not systematic. So here we made a systematic approach to compactness uniqueness, which finally is quite similar to compactness uniqueness for exactly controllable systems. Mm. So there is no smallness.
Okay, very nice. I have a last question, but here in the chat, there is another question. So
I'm not sure I understand the question of
Hernan
Cortez, which the effect of the perturbation in the solution. I don't exactly know what you mean by that.
Can you open your microphone and specify better the question, Hernan?
I would like to know about the method. About the filter Kalman, about the perturbation of the parameters, né? I would like to know.
So this is just in finite dimensions. So this is just in finite dimension. And I mentioned, so in general, the range of phi tau is given by this. You can easily see that if I can just, if this range is all the space, of course, this operator will be onto. And if I make a small perturbation of A, it will still be onto. But if this is if this is not X, then you can very easily see that you modify A very, very, very few. So for instance, imagine that A has eigenvector, some eigenvalues. And you can, one being very small, you can just remove one eigenvalue, which becomes zero, and everything will change. So this space can change a lot by a very small perturbation of A. So I don't look directly to the solution, I look to the Kalman matrix. Okay, so this Kalman matrix can, the range of it can be modified a lot, just making a very small perturbation of A. Only in the case when it is not, so because what does it mean? It means that this matrix does not contain all the range of this matrix does not contain all the directions. Okay, but assume that there is a small parameter in A, which allows you to go in a certain direction. If you remove this small parameter, which is a very small perturbation with respect to the norm, then you will lose everything. So that's not everything, but you will modify your reachable space. So that's, I don't know if this is the answer, but anyhow, the Kalman applies only for finite dimensional systems. For infinite dimensional system, I don't know. But what happens for infinite dimensional one? If I take, for instance, a heat equation, Z dot is equal to Z at X plus P of X Z, what will happen here? I can take even a very small P, but a P just L infinity. This will dramatically change my reachable space, even if it's small in L infinity. Why? Because if I put this PFX, which is L infinity, I cannot expect solutions to be analytic, holomorphic. I cannot, just it's obvious. Just adding a small P for a heat equation, you will lose regularity unless it is analytic. So our result asks P to be analytic, and not only ask it to be analytic, at least in a certain set, and to be small also in that set. So you can lose in fact robustness if you make a perturbation which is not in the reachable space. That's the idea. Good perturbation should take values in the reachable space if you want to hope robustness. And this is even true in finite dimensions.
One question, Professor. Are you receiving in your institute some teacher? Because I would like to work with your person. Is it possible to work in your institute?
Of course. We need to find what does it mean? We have to find let's say a framework, but there are possibilities, yes, of course. There are possibilities, but this needs to be discussed a bit in advance. And normally there are procedures. We have to find the funding. That's the first problem. And once we have a funding, we still need something like unfortunately, administration takes 3 months at least to get all the agreements and then come for the period for which we have the funding, there is no problem. But we have first to look for the funding. There are several possibilities, both in Brazil or in other countries and in France. And then you have this bureaucracy, which is another step, which has to be, tackled. Salt.
Okay, thank you, Professor.
Welcome. Is there any other question? I have a last question. In the case in which you have no local term, right? So the kernel could depend on time.
Yes.
But when you have potential, the potential cannot depend on time. I do not understand.
It can depend on time.
It can depend on time.
There are assumptions. Yeah, there are conditions in which it can depend on time. So in our paper, it is possible.
But
it's a particular dependence. It should be bounded with values in the reachable space always.
As for the kernel, right?
Yes, for the kernel the same. So okay. For the kernel, in fact,
okay.
Otherwise, there is clearly no chance because my trajectory will get out of the initial reachable space at some moment. Mm-hmm. So there are assumptions on the dependence on time. There are some theorems in our work. Yeah.
Very nice. So. Marios, I would thank you again for this wonderful talk.
So, I thank you for the invitation again.
So I will
thank you for the talk. Thanks a lot. So I will stop sharing my screen now.
Yes, thank you. So Juan, the word is yours.
Thank you, Diego, and thank you a lot, Professor Mario Tuznak, for your amazing talk.